facts are that I never quite signed up my contract in India Today. Because I did go there, the intention was to join. But I think in a couple of weeks, because the idea was and our arrangement was that I will join there, but I will also develop a product of my own, like the print, which became the print. And I figured that if I got fully involved in India Today, there'll be no time left for that. And I thought at this point, did I need a regular wage-paying job more? Exciting, interesting, India Today is a large organization. Or would I be better off taking a risk and focusing on doing something on my own? So the idea of building a new newsroom, I think, was more fascinating. So that's a choice I made. So I think within weeks, we had a conversation, Arun Puri and I, and we decided that I wasn't continuing. And I think it's the best decision we took. I will tell you where the name, the print, also came in. Although this name was tossed earlier in our conversations with some in our brainstorming, but on Sharad Pawar's 75th birthday celebration took place in Delhi. So we were all invited, and I had another eminent former editor sitting next to me, who I shall not name because why blame him for it. And I said to him, someone senior to me and much older than me. So I said to him that, look, I was just coming in and I read this article on one of the digital platforms by its editor, saying that with this 75th birthday celebration where Modi, Sonia Gandhi, Pranab Mukherjee, everybody was coming, Sharad Pawar now had emerged as the main candidate to be the next president of India. So I said, you know, this is the 75th birthday. This is Indian politics. Everybody is a hypocrite. Everybody will land up if you invite them on a 75th birthday. It doesn't mean that they'll make Sharad Pawar the president. And if Narendra Modi has such a full majority and BJP can get their own president elected, why would they give it to Sharad Pawar? So what kind of analysis do you get from such a senior, experienced byline who should know better? And I was almost about to mention the name of the person, but I will not, for good reason. So this person said, look, that's what happens when you go from print to digital. You lower your guard and you lower the bar because you think digital mein sab kuch chalta hai. Print is different. So then we thought that let print be the name, because that's a way of saying that while our platform is digital, we apply the diligence of print media. So there was a little twist to that. Now, reach of digital, of course, digital reaches a lot more than print. And at the same time, as I said, substance of print. So we don't, in a rush to catch the first, algorithm, we don't rush with this story unless we've checked it out. I think several things happened. One, I think a great team came along. Some experienced people, some among those who had worked together, and some who we didn't even know. So they came in, and a good new leadership team came in. And then we attracted a lot of bright, very young people. So there's nothing more satisfying than building a new newsroom for an editor. So now that newsroom is there. So that came in. And the third thing that happened was Indian politics and journalism both got very polarized. So as it's a line I wish I had invented it, but someone else did, that half the news organizations seem to have become Chamcha and the other half Morcha. So in that situation, the idea of space opened up for an organization which was non-hyphenated. Although I must say, that on any given day, somebody will accuse you of you being hyphenated. But if it is, you get attacked by both left and the right, you must be doing something right. The first thing was the speed. See, first of all, I tell you, for traditional journalists, the most unsettling thing is knowing immediately how many people are reading you. Because when you publish in a newspaper, your neighbors will say, "Maine pad liya." Your family will say, "Maine pad liya." Your landlord will say, "Maine pad liya." Your 25 sources and friends will say, "Maine pad liya." So you think it's been a big hit. But digital, you know immediately aap kitne pani mein ho. So that is a big thing, eye-opener in digital. The other thing is, in digital, you realize that, one, you have the benefit that you have enormous space, endless space, limitless space. But you also realize that the reader has limited time. So how do you find the balance between quality, length of an article, a reader's mind space? The battle is about mind space. So I think those are things that you learn with, of course, that you learn minor craft of it, like keywords and all that. But because ultimately digital is at the mercy of artificial intelligence. There is competition, but I would say that we have grown phenomenally in this period. So we must be doing something right. The other thing is that this will settle at some point. But legacy media will then realize that while they may get a lot of traffic on internet, but their cost base because of the newspapers and TV channels is very high. So we can build the same mind space impact and the same audiences at a much lesser cost, because we don't need a printing plant, we don't need a studio, we don't need to give money for distribution to cable channels. So I think the economics of news media will now get completely redefined. And let us see, I think it'll be a bigger challenge. It's a big challenge for us because we are so new and we have no reserves and we hardly have any revenues. They're only beginning to come in now, slowly. But legacy organizations also have much larger cost bases. So they will have to look at that very carefully. Well, ultimately, I think everybody will go behind paywall, at least for some of their products. We are not yet behind a paywall, but we are appealing to our readers, saying, like, look, we are not going behind a paywall. We are offering this to you for free. But if you appreciate good journalism, you should voluntarily pay for it, but not as donation, as subscription. So you don't have to. But if you appreciate good journalism and you know that without you paying for it, it cannot be sustained, pay for it. And we are encouraged by the fact that a lot of people are. I wish more would, and we'll keep trying. But at some point in the future, we will put something behind the paywall, if not everything. But right now, we are not doing that. Well, it worked very well, Democracy Ball. It was a partnership with Facebook, and we had two seasons of it over 2 years. Now, third season we'll figure out, because it's an on-ground event, so because of COVID, you can't do anything on-ground. We'll figure it out, but we are starting something new now called Campus Voice, or CV, where we will now be opening up the opinion field and asking bona fide students to write opinion on key issues of the day. And we'll choose the 3 best every week and give them very good prizes and publish those on our platform. So otherwise in India, opinion industry is controlled by 20-30 bylines, including mine. So we are just trying to widen this reach now. idea behind this was that I found that a lot of journalists were tweeting. And they were saying stuff on Twitter, which was being read a lot. And not all of them, most of them were not doing faltu tweeting. They were making good points. So I thought, if you can make a good point in a tweet, what is an editorial? An editorial is not an analytical article. Editorial is a point of view. So why can't you state your editorial view in a tweet? So I just calculated 280 characters is what a tweet allows. So I calculated 280 characters is about 50 words. So that's how the idea of a 50-word edit came. That 280 words is a long tweet. It looks like a lot to read. So if you can't make your editorial point, you agree with something, don't agree with something, why? Then you're wasting somebody's time. Why should people read 400, 500 words, 600 word edits? If you can make the same point in 50 words. So it's a challenge, but I think it's quite popular and it's working well. It's, I think, in a way, it betrays my vintage, in the sense that, see, all the brands that you remember, you know, most of you will not know the biscuit or brand called J.B. Mangaram, right? But if somebody says J.B. Mangaram to me, I can get the flavor of the biscuit in my nostrils. So there are lots of brands which were part of our lives of growing up. And a lot of people are grown up. Not everybody is a teenager. So this was one partly nostalgia, partly India's social history, because brands tell you your social history. The history of colas in India tells you India's economic history. It's the only country in the world, I think, where the government produced a cola. The Janata Party government produced a cola. After George Fernandez threw Coca-Cola out, that government produced a cola called Double Seven, because that government had come into power in 1977. So these brands tell us a lot of things. And this is also things that you can now research. You can find old commercials, and it's very interesting. Also, many of these brands are about products which are not relevant anymore, or which are not used anymore. Who uses a Murphy radio anymore? Everybody watches a film called Murphy because that kid was called Murphy, the Murphy baby. So how many people today relate themselves to the Murphy baby? So this is an interesting thing, and I think we tossed with the idea. I think somebody said brand pa, and we have a newsroom full of women, so we said no, brand ma, not brand pa. It's a mother brand, not papa brand. I think, I mean, if you ask me, I mean, I'd love to say I planned it, I'm a genius, but no such thing happened. I think one thing led to another. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, what helps you is your innate or obsessive curiosity. Curiosity, if you are happy to meet new kinds of people, I think that's the best thing about a journalist's life, because you end up, it's the opportunity to meet a lot of people who are much brighter than you, who are much more talented than you in many different fields. And when you do that, then you have to read up on them, you have to understand about them, and you learn from them. So I think it's just curiosity which keeps taking one from one thing to the other. Well, Katta Clutter again is a concept that came in Chalte Chalte, because once again we realized that people were getting very bored with TV, that it was all debates, so-called debates where you know who's on which side. So gali galoj, debate, but you get no understanding of news. And also the institution of the daily news bulletin has now disappeared from anywhere. So The idea was to choose one or two of the major stories of the day, where people may be watching a lot of debate and discussion, but may not be understanding the basics. So cut the clutter usually is done by taking off the layers of a complex story without taking a position. So occasionally when I do take a position, I often say so that I will also give you my opinion. But it's essentially looking at the facts of a story and also then speaking from experience, experience comes in both ways. Experience comes from finding examples that one may be familiar with, but also from being able to know where to find the information. And I have, we have very good young team. So at any point of time, one or two of those young people help me. Well, look, I work in chaos. I cannot work in a structured way. So at one level, it's a negative. That's the reason I'll make a very bad bureaucrat. So my mind is entrepreneurial. You can call it creative. So I'm always thinking of a new mischief. So that's how this idea of this campus voice is coming. Let us see if it works, but I think it will work. Because nobody has tried it as yet. And I do think that we have to now challenge the opinion industry in India. Because the same 2030 bylines talk about everything. I think you have to democratize opinion without trivializing it. Well, first of all, nobody can be completely free of one's own predilections or biases. But that's where professionalism comes in. And that's where the role of the editor comes in. Okay. So in any organization, newsroom, there have to be layers. Okay. Even when I write something, somebody edits it very carefully. And I defer to the person who edits it. So in fact, one change that you might find, say, with my writing now, my national interest, a lot of people now tell me that it's much pithier, it's much more crisp than before. And I will tell you the reason why. Because now there is an editor I'm afraid of. Because when I was my own editor in the Express, I could write routinely 1700 words, 1800 words. Space will be made, second article will be dropped, right? Yahan ke hame Rajkumar, right? But now this column also goes in Business Standard.
Okay, yes.
Business Standard, the editorial chairman is T.N. Nainan, who was my editor in India Today a long time back, who I respect enormously. So I know if a faltu likhega, to Nainan kya bolega. Second, I know that I can't say that because they can only take 1250 words. So I routinely write 1700, 1800. Then I cut it down to 1200, 1250. And I'm able to now do it in no time. So that discipline is working well for me. That discipline wasn't there when I was my own editor. So everybody needs an editor. Look, flak will come. If you don't want flak, don't do it. So it's the old line. I think Truman said it. If you can't face the heat, get out of the kitchen. So flak will come. So you have to deal with flak. But look, as long as you know that you are not coming from an agenda, that's a good place to begin with. And second, accept that you can make mistakes. And when you make a mistake, say sorry. Then don't either try to compound the mistake by insisting that no, this must be right, or by trying to duck and say this will pass. If it's a mistake, then say sorry. In fact, audiences quite appreciate the fact that you admitted to a mistake. Of course, you can't do it every day. You can't make a mistake every day. But if you do, make as few mistakes as possible, but when you do, then grab your ears and say, sorry, I shouldn't have. Well, I mean, my answer to that is a very straightforward one. I am very parochial when it comes to our profession. That when you give me citizen doctors and citizen lawyers, I will give you citizen journalists. So journalism is a profession. You have to be trained for it. You need skills for it. And you have to be held responsible for what you do. So citizen journalism for me is a nothing concept. And I don't buy into it. Frankly, I think it's an abomination. First of all, they are so much brighter, and they are hungry, and they are curious. So these are very good qualities. Second, I'd say, just from personal experience, that I was similarly spoiled by my editors when I was that age. I was sent to cover the Northeast, which was India's most sensitive beat, by Arun Shori when I wasn't even 24 yet. So you have to trust people, you have to trust your own instinct that I think so-and-so, if I push so-and-so into water, so-and-so will swim, not drown. But if somebody is drowning, you're always there to be the lifeguard and to rescue the person. And I find that one does quite well with that over time. So you should not hold anybody's youth against them. The second thing is, a lot of stories are to be done by young people. So when war in Kargil was going on, sometimes senior people in the army elsewhere would get irritated with some of our stories. And our reporters were very young. In fact, one of them is Gaurav Sawant, who's now with India Today. So I know he's 1974 born. So he was 25 years old during the war in Kargil. And he was covering it. And once I got a call from a very angry retired general saying, why do you send these 25, 23-year-olds to cover the war in Kargil? Why don't you senior people go? So I said, sir, why do you send these 23, 24-year-old captains to take those peaks? Why don't you generals go and take those peaks? So some things are to be done by young people. Some things are to be done by older people. So a lot of these stories are for younger people. Well, I don't know what can I say. I can say safely that one, become a journalist. One thing that will never stop in India is good stories and surprises. Because there's very little you can anticipate in India. Because you don't know what will happen tomorrow. That's very good for journalism. The second thing is, just by way of people ask me advice, so two bits of advice. Just to be a journalist, stay curious. Everything else somebody can teach you. Somebody can rewrite you. Somebody can teach you language. Somebody can help you get the sources. But you have to be curious. Because if you are not curious, then you can't be a successful journalist. And third, if you grow into a leadership position, have a big heart. Because nobody can be a good leader without having a big heart.